The Humble Perf Board, a useful tool for any maker wanting to make their project more permanent. And I hate it. It's just so cumbersome to use. Even soldering on simple circuits takes a long time. And more importantly, there is no Control Z if you accidentally make a wrong connection. On the other hand, soldering components to a PCB is one of the great joys of a maker. Kind of. Of course, there are many services that'll make them for you for relatively cheap. But, just like cookies, homemade is always better. Except you can't eat circuit boards. Anyway, if you don't know the process of making PCBs, it involves applying a photosensitive mask, called photoresist, to a blank circuit board, and then exposing a pattern to it. Next, the unexposed photoresist can be washed off and the copper underneath etched away. And then finally, the remaining photoresist is removed. The rest is black magic, and the intricate details are a closely guarded secret by those who have spent years mastering the skill. But, despite all this, an important aspect of this process is exposing the photoresist correctly. To do this, many newcomers, including me, wanted to turn to a natural, sustainable source of UV light, and turn to the sun for help. But the elitists wanted something more. Something that would work at night. Something that would give consistent results. So special boxes with UV light sources in them were developed. But there's no way I'm going to pay $500 just for a box with some light bulbs in it. So to show that this technology can be accessed by even the average hobbyist, I'm going to make my own DIY solution. Just like hundreds of other people have done before. For the light source, I'm going to use around 100 of these cheap 5mm UV LEDs. And since LEDs are diodes, they need some sort of current limiting to not blow up. So, I will use a constant current driver for this. Also, something to note is that you can't put LEDs directly in parallel, even with current limiting. This is due to manufacturing inconsistencies which cause a differing forward voltage between LEDs. Therefore, the LED with the lowest forward voltage will be shunting the most amount of current. This not only means inconsistent light output across your LEDs, but also means that the LED with the lowest forward voltage will die quicker, and when it dies, the next LED with the lowest forward voltage will take up the burden, and the cycle repeats until there are no more working LEDs. Since I will be putting LEDs in series, a boost converter will be necessary to overcome the higher forward voltage. One well-suited for the task can be purchased for quite cheap, but the most exciting thing about that would be reading the mistranslated Chinese on the packaging. Luckily, making your own boost converter isn't that hard. There are many proof-of-concept designs online that use an Arduino as a main control IC, but the code running on those is extremely simple, making it essentially just a comparator in disguise. And not only is using an Arduino unnecessary, but the output regulation of this design is not that good. Instead, my design will be centered around the almighty NE555. Because every DIY project has to have at least one. So like any good engineer, with design goals in mind, I googled it. This one off the EEV blog forum looks good enough. I won't go into too much detail on how it works, but it's a fairly clever circuit. In essence, it turns on Q1, which lets current flow through L1 and then measures that current with RQ. Once a current exceeds a set threshold, it turns off Q1 for a set amount of time, which is determined by some resistors and capacitors. And it also monitors the output voltage using a voltage divider formed by R1 and R2. The power output of this in its current configuration will not be sufficient to drive all of the LEDs, so I'll modify some of the values to suit my needs. It works in SPICE, so I'll build it on a breadboard just to verify that everything works as intended. And... that's strange. I think that's just due to some stray capacitance in the breadboard messing up the feedback. For simplicity and speed, I'll just put it on a... Oh no. Okay, it's done. Let's test it. And... You know what? Scrap that! I'll just design my own circuit that actually works. Here it is. This time I will go into a lot of detail. To understand it, we'll need to take a look at the internal schematic of the NE555. It's fairly simple, it just boils down to a few comparators and a flip-flop. We can ignore the discharge pin since we won't be using it. D1 and D2 are connected to the control pin of the NE555 and set the reference voltage for the comparators to around 1.4 volts. The voltage at both the trigger and threshold pins will be 0 volts. Since the voltage on the positive input of the trigger comparator will be higher than that of the voltage on its negative input, it will go high, setting the flip-flop, causing the output to go high. Over here, we can see that it will quickly charge up C1 through a 4-volt regulator. The voltage at the positive input of the trigger comparator will now be above 0.7 volts, or half the reference voltage, causing it to turn off. This is fine since the flip-flop will still be set. On the other side of the circuit, the MOSFET will turn on due to the output being high. This in turn will let current start to flow through L1. On its way to ground, it will pass through a pair of 1-ohm resistors, forming a half-ohm resistor. The voltage across them will rise, which means that the voltage at the threshold pin of the NE555 will also rise. Once the voltage at that pin exceeds 1.4 volts, the internal flip-flop will latch, causing the output to go low, turning off the MOSFET. Then, the sudden cutoff of current flowing through the inductor will cause the voltage after it to rise. We can then use D4 to direct the current to the output. Also, since there is no longer current flowing through the resistor pair R9 and R10, the voltage at the NE555 threshold pin will no longer be above 1.4 volts. To prevent the MOSFET from turning right back on again, I use a circuit over here. When the output of the NE555 is high, C1 will be at 4 volts. Then, when the output is low, C1 discharges through R1, causing a delay. Once the voltage is below 0.7 volts, the trigger comparator will turn on, setting the flip-flop and causing the output to go high again. And the cycle repeats. At this point, the output voltage is still unregulated. That's where this part of the circuit comes in. On the right, we have a 50:1 voltage divider. On the left side, we have a comparator with the negative input connected to the reference voltage of 0.7 volts, and the positive input connected to our voltage divider. When the voltage at the positive input of the comparator goes above 0.7 volts, corresponding to around 35 volts output voltage, it will go high. This will turn on Q2, causing the NE555 to be pulled into a reset state, stopping the oscillation, and will continue to do so until the output voltage dips below 35 volts again. Okay, now that we know the theory, it's time to test it. Again, I will put it on a breadboard. Hopefully this time it actually works. And it does! Yes! Now that I got that out of the way, all I need to do to finish this project is to... Oh.